know, being here reminds me of my primary school days. I had my friends all around me, and we were the bright ones. So, you know, we always listened to Mrs. Pencil. She was a great teacher. Memories, memories. Anyway, today, GIS is at the Almondtown Primary School, and they're going to be sharing about how they intend to salute their teachers this Teacher's Day.
Welcome to Almondtown Primary School!
Also coming up, a review of the Prime Minister's contribution to the budget debate, as well as highlights of the priorities for this financial year, 2014 to 2015, and later, creating master mathematicians. I'm Audrey Williams. Stay with us.
Good day, I'm Andrea Chisholm, and this is your GIS News for Wednesday, May 7. 2016 still remains the deadline for the implementation of the 381 megawatt energy project as the government moves ahead to achieve lower electricity rates for the country. During his sectoral presentation in Parliament Tuesday, Energy Minister Philip Powell said the cabinet was appointing an enterprise team to oversee its full implementation. Dr. Vincent Lawrence is to head the six-member team, which will include two persons nominated by the private sector.
The enterprise team will report to the Prime Minister, the Cabinet. The enterprise team will be mandated to have the project implemented by 2016.
Energy World International EWI had been granted the license to construct the power plant, but in the wake of the company's delayed payment of a $36.85 million US dollar performance security bond, the Inter-American Development Bank has said it is not willing to finance the project. So on Cabinet's instruction, the Energy Minister is to consult with the OUR about revoking EWI's license. But Minister Powell stressed that government remained determined to see the project completed and said some positives had come from the process with EWI.
Because before EWI, I was being bombarded by people who wanted to pursue sourcing, and I couldn't get them to budge below 19 cents. I have every confidence now that we will be able to achieve that initial 30% reduction because a benchmark has been set thanks to EWI.
Meanwhile, Minister Philip Powell has announced that under a new bauxite policy, there will be no new agreements to export raw bauxite without specific conditions. This has led to the signing of a memorandum of understanding between the government and the China-based firm Xinhua Group earlier this year.
This foreign direct investment amounts to approximately $3 billion United States dollars.
Under the MOU, Xinhua will construct a 2 million ton per annum alumina plant to operate for 25 years and a coal-fired power plant to support the alumina plant. A negotiation team to include a technical specialist in environmental management is tasked with settling the terms of definitive agreements within 6 months.
This means, Mr. Speaker, that on successful completion of the negotiations, we will not only be mining bauxite in that area of St. Anne, as was the case with the Reynolds mine. We will be producing alumina from St. Anne for the first time at last. And this will be the first greenfield alumina facility to be constructed in Jamaica in 42 years.
A precise location is to be determined after further consultation. Less than a week after approving a country partnership strategy for Jamaica, the World Bank has given government a $42 million loan for an integrated community development project. The World Bank signed the loan agreement Tuesday with the Ministry of Finance and the Jamaica Social Investment Fund, which will implement the project. The Integrated Community Development Project will improve access to basic services such as healthcare and waste collection, upgrade basic infrastructure like roads and drainage, and undertake targeted crime and violence interventions in 18 vulnerable inner-city communities. It will build on the success of the Inner City Basic Services Program, which came to an end in December 2013. Under the new program, 80,000 Jamaicans will benefit, with particular focus on at-risk males and unattached children, youth and young adults. Jamaica's tourism industry is getting a brand new attraction that will also deliver an added dimension to the country's maritime and education sectors. On Tuesday, the Port Authority of Jamaica signed a memorandum of understanding with Paradise Express Ferry to implement a high-speed catamaran ferry service on the North Coast. Industry, Investment and Commerce Minister Anthony Hilton has welcomed the investment from New York-based businessman Gary Johnson, who spent his early childhood in Jamaica.
This ferry project via high-speed catamaran plans to give visitors a new attraction, a new vantage point from which to view a beautiful island. A unique vacation experience for tourists and Jamaican residents alike.
The MOU allows Paradise Express to get a UDC lease to develop two government-owned lots on the Montego Bay waterfront. In line with that, a publicly accessible boardwalk will be constructed. The ferry service is to be initially operated in Ocho Rios, Montego Bay and Negril starting the first quarter of 2015. And finally, the Rural Agricultural Development Authority, RADA, is encouraging all farmers to get in line with regulations for them to be registered. RADA CEO Lenworth Fullerton says this has now become necessary as the agency moves to get all farmers' information into the Agricultural Business Information System.
As a problem arises in this country, and so the system is there, and it will be beneficial to farmers who register. They can tap into them and call them individually, and they will be better able to sign good contracts, fair contracts between themselves and these other individuals, other business people.
RADA CEO, who was speaking at a recent JIS think tank, said the system had approximately 167,000 registered farmers, of which about 144,000 had been verified. And that's it for JIS News Today. Amanda Chisholm, thank you for watching.
Today by being on my very best behavior and being her assistant for the day.
Educational facilities with adequate classrooms and proper sanitary facilities are just some of the targets for the educational sector for this financial year. Prime Minister Portia Simpson Miller will share with us some of the other targets for this sector as well as for others.
To realize our goals, we have to get the economy right. We're working toward making communities more livable through a coordinated strategy which includes rural development. We have always maintained a progressive, non-aligned, and forward-thinking foreign policy. We will not divert from this position. We are staying with the program of macroeconomic transformation. Let there be no doubt about that. One of this government's main priorities is to reduce the debt. We were seeking to ease the tax burden. We have to live, Mr. Speaker, within our means. We have no other choice but to spend less this year. To date, we have passed all quarterly IMF tests. Earlier this year, Fitch Ratings upgraded Jamaica to a B- rating and an overall positive outlook. The country's debt to GDP ratio is declining. There's evidence of growth in the following sectors of the economy, Mr. Speaker. Agriculture, tourism, construction, mining, and quarrying. The tough decisions we have taken and the painful adjustments, Mr. Speaker, we have had to make, they are bearing fruits. We're undertaking infrastructure development projects for Jamaica's success. And so during this fiscal year, the Jeep has been refueled to the value of $630 million. Yes. The section of the North Coast Highway from Linstead to Monique will be opened August. There are even more infrastructural projects currently underway. As a government, we're endeavoring to do more and to find new ways to facilitate our people, to help them to start and to maintain viable businesses. This year, we will begin the interministerial policy integration of critical ministries to streamline, Mr. Speaker, the applications of science and technology in development. The Cultural and Creative Industries Commission, which I chair, and the supporting interministerial technical working group have been established and have begun their work within the Office of the Prime Minister. We are expanding ownership in Jamaica by providing opportunities for more Jamaicans to own property. We will continue our efforts to attract both foreign and local investment to create jobs and to grow the economy. The Hospitant Group has made an initial investment of US $20 million to build a 16-room, 28-bed general hospital in Rose Hall, Montego Bay. We look forward to the opening of the first Marriott Courtyard property in New Kingston. Noranda Bauxite is investing US $18 million in expanding their port at Discovery Bay. All three telecoms, Digicel, Lime, and Flow, are getting hub ready. Many more companies are investing and diversifying their portfolios. We have restored Jamaica's credibility within the international community. In recognition of emerging global challenges, we have deepened and accelerated economic diplomacy. The government will be spending over $5.5 billion to safeguard the welfare of the vulnerable in our society. This government has, over the years, been at the forefront of implementing policies and programs to advance the cause of women.
Hear, hear.
We will not depart from this position. The Disabilities Bill will be tabled in this parliamentary year. I have given instructions that all government buildings must be made accessible to the disabled. Another four health centers are currently being refurbished. This includes the Center of Excellence in Dawkins Field. We are placing special emphasis on education and training as part of the framework of activities to benefit our youth. This government is working to get our nation where it needs to go. We are finding solutions. We are going for growth and development. We are working for the people.
Teachers' Day is important to students and teachers because students get a chance to show teachers how much they appreciate their work and teachers see how much their work is appreciated.
If you wanted the moon, I would try to make a star, but I would rather if you'd let me give my heart to
and justice and social inclusion and protection. They are geared toward improving all sectors of the country. Learn more in this upcoming feature.
Prime Minister Portia Simpson-Miller has asserted that her administration is working for the people.
In situations like ours, growth and development processes are complex. They do not happen overnight.
But the work is already in train. And this year, there are 6 strategic priorities. The first builds on the fiscal foundation laid last year.
Last financial year, it was primarily about negotiating a new medium-term agreement with the IMF. Government did that. This year, it's about staying the course, sticking with that IMF agreement, and passing all the quarterly reviews administered by the fund every 3 months. Fundamentally, there remains a determination to contain public expenditure, divest some key public assets, and continue the process of tax and pension reform.
Jamaica cannot continue to bar its way out of its troubles. That is why we have to make the economic adjustments.
Government's plan isn't only about spending more wisely. This year, the administration intends to put more people to work and keep the economy on a growth path.
We expect the rate of growth to continue to strengthen, especially as we continue to implement major reforms to enhance the business environment, as well as to intensify the efforts regarding strategic investment projects in tourism, transport, agri-parks, logistics, among others.
This year, particular attention will be paid to the development of 3 important growth areas. These are the cultural and creative economy, 2, innovation, science and technology, 3, for too long, we have not been, as a conscient government, paying enough attention to the nutraceuticals industry.
The government will be unrelenting in its efforts to reduce crime and build safer communities.
This year, the long-contemplated merger of the JCF and ISCF is being implemented. Significant capital investment will be made to upgrade the technology available for police investigation and operations. And programs aimed at promoting respect for life and stronger values will be implemented. At the same time, critical pieces of legislation will be pushed to fight crime and secure justice for Jamaicans.
My administration is of the firm view, Mr. Speaker, that our human resource must be at the heart of our growth and development strategy.
Building on the 2013-2014 foundation, a raft of measures is being pursued to ensure a healthy and educated population, like making it easier for young people to get SLV loans to fund their tertiary education and building more centers of excellence for better health services at the community level.
Women and men, children, the elderly, those on the streets and in infirmaries, the poor and the disabled will all be targeted for social intervention initiatives this fiscal year.
The government will be spending over $5.5 billion to safeguard the welfare of the vulnerable in our society.
$75 million of this amount will be spent on phase 2 of the short-term poverty intervention program.
This is not a new priority for the Portia Simpson-Miller administration. It is merely one that is increasingly finding center stage, and for a simple reason.
Apart from our people, the natural environment is our most precious resource. Its protection is critical to our economic and social development.
Among other things, this year we'll find government working to increase awareness on climate change in the public sector and the wider society, and generate information to guide adaptation and mitigation strategies, policies, and plans.
6 strategic priorities: fiscal prudence and pursuit of a credible macroeconomic program, economic growth and job creation, security and justice, human capital development, social inclusion and protection, environmental and climate change resilience, government in action, working to make Jamaica the place of choice to live, work, raise families, and do business.
Teacher by being her mini teacher. A good teacher is like a candle. It consumes itself to light the way for others. Takes the E out of extraordinary, a guide, a motivator, a friend and an educator. Enthusiastic about all my learning, but particularly when it comes to exams. Brilliant and beloved by many.
Mathematics, challenging, complex, can be a little frustrating, but also fun. For example, teaching a child the difference between odd and even numbers. The government believes that despite the challenges, this is a discipline that every child can master.
Many can recall reciting those lines in their first mathematics class, beaming with confidence as the timetable reels off the lips. But as the days multiply and square off into years, math is evolving into a feared subject, with many succumbing to that fear and failing exams. But fear not, help is on the way. Unfortunately for some people, just the thought of numbers freaks them out. Addition, multiplication, and division are frustrating computations. But the reality is, the ability to apply mathematical concepts to real-life circumstances is necessary for one's development. Math is about problem-solving and analytical thinking, skills required to be a productive member of society. A significant number of students at both the primary and secondary levels is not performing up to standard, a reality that's been captured in benchmark national exams.
Generally speaking, across the system, from the very earliest stages, we're beginning to see students struggling with the subject.
The students themselves do know the importance of math and want to excel in the subject. So when a group of them were offered an opportunity to change the statistics, they accepted. These students packed an auditorium at the University of the West Indies, Mona, during summer 2012 for a 3-2-1 math camp.
X union Y union Z equals, and then you write down all of those.
I want to be an entrepreneur. I want to do a car business, yeah, like sell cars and rent cars. Yeah. Math is important because with selling and renting cars, you'd have to need calculation.
People keep on telling me, but then I'm saying, I really don't like math, so. And then because I really want to do it, I'm after getting involved in math.
The Ministry of Education is adamant. Students must do well at math. The development of the country rests on it. But realizing this goal means eliminating the fear harbored by some students.
Once they're not getting things right, they start getting things wrong. The fear comes in and that just perpetuates the problem.
The culture of fear for math can also be perpetuated by parents.
The cultural acceptance that if you're not good at maths, that's all right. You know, I'm not good at it, so it's okay. We've had parents communicate that to teachers. Now, you know, me, so I wasn't good at the subject, so if he or she isn't so good at it, it's all right, don't be so rough on him or her.
That's exactly what educators want to change, because they know that if students don't grasp certain math concepts at an early stage, it can be difficult for their brains to appreciate the subject later.
One of the things they used to do is drills, timetable drills, because what will happen sometimes, they get used to the calculator, they don't understand the patterns and get the logic, so that later on they get something, put the information in the calculator, it gives them a wrong answer because they've put in something wrong and they don't realize it.
This brings into the equation the competence of teachers. Teachers must be qualified to identify the challenges faced by students and groom their minds to understand the concepts. And the educators need to enter the classroom freed of their own fears.
There was a survey done in 2009, I believe, by the ministry. And I think 20% of the primary teachers at the time spoke to being afraid of the subject and spoke to wanting not to have to teach the subject. We have teachers who come into the classroom, they pass on their gaps and fears to our children who become our future teachers.
Government is putting in the work to drive up the math numbers. Through the National Mathematics Scheme, two significant activities are taking place: an update of the numeracy policy drafted in 2003 and the development of a National Mathematics Strategic Plan.
The document is speaking to issues such as qualifications to teach the subject at various levels of the education system, and it also gives very clear guidelines and standards for what teacher education programs should look like.
It's going to take time, but with a clearer plan and everyone on board, the government is determined to solve the problem of mathematical failings, and we are all a part of the equation. So if you excelled in the subject, help someone who is struggling, whether it's a relative, a neighbor, or a friend. One plus one, helping each other, we can achieve 100.
I will honor my teacher by sharing East Indian mangoes with her because she loves them.
Visit our Facebook page or send us a tweet about the teachers you want to salute this Teacher's Day. And stay up to date by visiting our website and our YouTube channels. Remember, students, value your teachers. And teach, continue to inspire us.
Happy Teacher's Day!
This has been a production of the Jamaica Information Service, the voice of Jamaica.